Toy Story, Monsters, Inc., Finding Nemo, The Incredibles, Cars, Inside Out, Coco, Soul. What do these movies have in common? Well, they all come from the one, the only, Pixar Animation Studios. Let's just say I'm a pretty big fan of the studio. Sure, they may be in a bit of a pickle right now, and sure, some of their films are rough around the edges, but honestly, who cares? This is a studio filled with talented people who have poured all their heart and soul into some iconic animated features, most of which have had fun, creativity, emotion, and most of all, effort. So today I figured I'd pay tribute to this fantastic studio and review slash rank all 26 of their feature films so far. This is a project I've actually wanted to do for a while now. I know Shea Frillis and a ton of other people have done this before, but hey, who said I couldn't join the party? Okay. Anyway, without further ado, let's get stuck into it.
Endless trash!
Easily coming in last place for me is The Good Dinosaur. I'm not exaggerating. This movie is just, I do not like this movie. Like, it literally only exists for amazing landscapes, which I'll admit are stunning. Maybe a little too stunning around some bits, but there's no story. What little story this movie has feels like it was copy and pasted off other better Disney and Pixar movies. Arlo's dad dying and returning as a ghost is just Lion King again. And the basic plot with Arlo returning home feels too similar to some other Pixar Journey movies that are better, like Toy Story, Finding Nemo, or even Cars 2, which I'm sure you all expected to be at the very bottom of this list, but we'll get to that later. The rest of this movie is just really boring, filled with, like, ultimately unmemorable characters and some pretty bad writing and pacing. It's just, I don't like this movie. It's so boring. There's nothing really happening in this movie, and there's really not a whole lot to say about it. It's just not good. Its action sequences and animation are the only things I can praise it for, but it unfortunately can't save it from one of the messiest stories to come out of either Disney or Pixar. Which is sad, considering this is a movie studio that has always put story first, with emotional warmth and great animation second. It's also worth noting that this was Pixar's first box office bomb, so that's kind of sad, I guess.
Lang me your lumdy, give me a moose near Lee, you're gunning away a tear dab in his eye. Hey, she back me, lassie!
Brave is another one of my least favorite Pixar movies. I don't think it's all that good, which sucks. I think the opening is great. And the worst part is that the trailers make you to believe that it's actually gonna be good, at least in my opinion. There was potential in the trailers that made it seem like it was gonna be interesting and weird and creative. But then when you watch the movie, it's basically what you got from Disney. I mean, yeah, they did attempt some mysteries, and I thought some of it was kind of interesting, but that's it. Everything in this movie just felt really rehashy from what you'd expect in your typical Disney princess movies. But I didn't hate a lot of it. I like Merida enough, but she's not really all that interesting aside from the basics. She just wants to be free and live out her life, which is cool, but that's it. She never really has a lot of other personality traits either. And the rest of the cast doesn't really hold up that well either. The majority of this movie doesn't really feel all that unique. There's not much good comedy, and it doesn't have compelling storytelling either. The only parts that I enjoyed and even loved was the scene where Lord Dingwall was showing his butt off at Macintosh and MacGuffin, and he makes a kid in the background cry. Another scene that I liked was when Merida goes against her mother's orders and shoots her arrow through another arrow. Like, come on, that's pure art. And the final scene with Merida embracing her mother and admitting that everything was her fault was really emotional and touching that I really wish the rest of the movie was the same way, but nah, it's not. It could have been better if they had just kept the original director on board. A Bug's Life is pretty forgettable for a number of reasons. Okay, I'll get my bad stuff out of the way. This movie really goes overboard with this whole liar reveal plotline that doesn't really make all that sense. The whole misunderstanding where Flick thinks they're warrior bugs only to find out they're part of a circus was kind of dumb too. I hate how everyone is such a jerk to Flick for no apparent reason whatsoever. Which, I can see why they hate him now, after all he's the one who straight up dumped his running harvest service near the food for the grasshoppers, but for the most part it fell out of nowhere and I felt bad for Flick in some places. The rest of this movie I didn't really find all too interesting. I mean, the animation is stellar, but the characters are alright? I don't really care for some of them that much. Sometimes the jokes are funny, the environments are really impressive, and the action sequences are amazing, but for the most part, I did not like it. I know this movie has its fans, and that's perfectly fine. Unfortunately, I'm not one of them.
I'm old.
Cars 3 is easily the weakest one. I'm gonna be honest with you, Cars 3 is my least favorite movie to come from this franchise. What I don't really like about this movie is the pacing. I understand the majority of this movie is about Lightning training to become faster than Storm, but it kind of drives the pacing to a halt and it makes a lot of this movie really boring. Speaking of which, the villain is basically Chick Hicks, but less funny, and he doesn't really add anything to the story other than being Lightning's competition. I also don't really get the whole Lightning is old thing the movie is going for, despite him looking and sounding exactly how he did in the first two movies. But yeah, this movie is not terrible, I'm not saying that. It's still all about racing and legacy and all that stuff. I did like Cruz a lot in this movie, and her backstory is kinda sad. I also like how Lightning gave her a chance to pursue her dream in the big race, which I thought was really cool. And the scene with Lightning in his all-new Doc Hudson look is one of the best scenes in the entire movie, at least in my opinion. He's finally coming to terms with his age and found a new purpose in racing, like Doc did. Lightning is the new Doc, and Cruz is the new Lightning. Yeah, some of it is good and some of it is bad, but I didn't have a horrendous time with it, thankfully. Like, yeah, it's alright. There's just not a whole lot to say about it, and it's not really one of my all-time favorites.
To infinity and beyond!
Okay, so Lightyear is kind of a weird movie to talk about. A huge origin story about Buzz Lightyear seems like an interesting idea on paper, and I did have fun with some parts of it, but most of it was not all that good, at least in my opinion. A few problems I have with this movie is the plotline with Buzz's motivation. He feels as if he has to save everyone because he owes it to everyone living there and that it was his mistake. Which is cool, but no one really seems to care about his mistake. They're all just living their lives just fine. There isn't as much emotion to the storyline as the movie tries to give it. It focuses on some of it, but it just comes off as rushed and is just there. In fact, that's the main problem I have with this movie. The story. It felt as if it was skipping in some places, and the direction it tried to take fell off. There's weirdly not that much development in most of the scenes it takes place in. Zurg honestly didn't make all that much sense to me. I feel like they didn't explain enough why he turned into this maniacal monster. Also, he didn't look that intimidating, surprisingly, making him such a forgettable and kind of bad twist villain. This movie does, however, have amazing animation, its action is still tense and awesome, Sox is really funny, the music slaps, its main characters were entertaining, especially Taika Waititi's character, but man, it has such an incredibly weak plot and direction that it's really not all that good. Though I do wish it performed better at the box office if people weren't so overworked by that same sex kiss. Like, people, come on, she's an LGBT. I know most people think Cars 2 is such a terrible movie, and I'm totally fine with people who have those negative thoughts. With that said, I adore this movie, man. It is such a blast of a movie and of a sequel in so many ways that it's just hard to hate it. This movie's concept and story has got to be up there as one of the weirdest and perhaps funnest to ever come out of Pixar. Every character, relationship, and plot point in this movie makes no sense, to the point where it's not an exaggeration to call Mater, of all characters, smarter than all of them combined. Literally everything people dislike about Pixar is wrapped up in this insane, balls-to-the-wall blast of a sequel. It might actually be the true worst Pixar sequel and movie in general, but I couldn't exactly rank it last because of its memorability and how insane it is. There is just something about Cars 2 and its insane plot structure that makes it all the more entertaining, and how, despite it being the worst Pixar movie right now, I can't bring myself to hate it. It's an absolute fun time, and I love it.
Expecto Patronum!
Onward is another underrated Pixar movie that's not all that great. A few problems I have with Onward is Chris Pratt's voice acting as Barley. Like, he's a good actor, but there's something about his voice that kind of threw me off a bit. Like, it's weirdly smug. Also, don't you think Barley's character design was inspired by Jack Black's performance in The School of Rock? He could have been a much better choice to voice Barley. It would be so much better. But hey, it could have been much worse. Also, the way Barley is written in general could have been fleshed out more if he really was Ian's true father figure. Speaking of writing, the idea of a fantasy world that switched to modern technology is a neat idea, but to me personally, they don't do anything interesting with it. Every character the main characters come across that stop using their magical abilities immediately regain them accidentally. It's not all that creative. Though, on top of its mediocrity, it does have a sweet central message about sibling relationships. I like the dynamic between the two brothers. Ian is embarrassed by his brother because of his obsession with the past. Barley is a fun individual who remembers magic and the olden days. I like how this movie progresses. It furthers deeper into the brothers' relationship, and they start to have a great time with each other. This movie was really relatable to me. I mean, I have a little sister who would often get embarrassed and angry with me, and I'm usually the goofy, positive, but still understandable one. The scene where Ian has flashbacks of him and Barley's life is got to me the most. Seeing that Barley was always there for Ian got me kind of emotionally invested, and that it reminded me of my life right now. My relationship with my sister hasn't changed much, but I usually remind myself that I will always love her and be there for her through the good and the bad, and I'm happy this movie exists for that message alone. This is one of those few movies that actually helped me out in my own life. But that doesn't mean this movie is automatically a masterpiece. It has some good elements, but it didn't quite stick the landing.
Man, I haven't been on a trip like that since college!
Monsters University is what I believe to be the only Pixar movie that seems to have the most mixed reception. Like, for a movie that has no reason to exist or have been made, it was actually pretty decent, and I don't mind its existence. I like Mike and Sully's relationship at the beginning of the movie, where they feel the need to one-up each other. I also like seeing some of the other characters again. Randall starts off as Mike's friendly roommate, Ross is still a member of the CDA, and I did like seeing the Abominable Snowman before he was banished. I also appreciated the vibe this movie was going for, since the kids who grew up with the first Monsters, Inc. would have probably been packing their bags and moving to college around the time this movie was released. I also like how there's a science to scaring, like there's more to it than you think, and how every monster has a different unique technique that makes them scary in their own ways. It's a pretty cool message that this movie also excels at. Like, Mike wanted to be a scarer so badly, but it didn't work out. But that's okay, because he found purpose in scaring through his coaching with Sully and the rest of the team, leading to one heck of an incredible climax. However, that doesn't mean the rest of the movie is all that good. I think the pacing drives to a halt a little bit when the scare game's plot hits in. The side characters aren't my favorites. The story is a bit weak in some areas, like it's basically just your average college movie. I also hate the fact that Mike is the only member of their team that gets singled out for dragging the team down. I mean, none of the other characters look scary, but not even none of them were called out. So yeah, this movie could have been great, and it does have some unique underrated stuff in it. Still, I appreciate the effort, and for what it's worth. It's also not as heartfelt as the original, which is kind of shocking for Pixar. But hey, at least we had some laughs, right? Cars 1 is easily the best one of the trilogy. It tells a really driving story of a hotshot show-off that learns to enjoy the simple way of life. Lightning's character arc has somehow been able to work well for me, mostly. I like how he starts off as a big a-hole that doesn't need help from his team, but after getting lost and stumbling upon the little town of Radiator Springs, and accidentally destroying an entire road, he's now stuck there. But along the way, you can see him start to grow as a character and slowly starting to befriend Mater and Sally. I also like how Doc didn't like him for the extent of the stay, but then during the race, he truly realizes how much Lightning has changed for the better. And this all leads up to a really wholesome ending. Cars 1 admittedly is still decent, yet a classic. It's funny, emotional, and the plot is actually pretty decent. I still think it's just okay, but hey, I didn't hate this movie. But yeah, it's very underrated and deserves more love.
Honey.
Thank you.
Sorry guys, I didn't really care for WALL-E that much. It's like a 6 out of 10 for me. Don't get me wrong, the things that are great about this movie are outstanding. It has some fantastic graphics, some romantic scenes with both the robots and the humans. The final part where WALL-E and Eve put their heads against each other is really amazing, and it kinda got me tearing up a little bit. But the rest of the scenes that don't involve WALL-E and Eve's love story kind of drags on and on and becomes really boring. Also, why couldn't this entire movie just be about them returning to Earth? That would have made up for the first half of the movie, which is also kind of boring, with some funny moments here and there. And don't even get me started on the villain. Otto is such a boring, stupid wheel that is just programmed to do what he's been assigned and never gives out his own options or thoughts. Since many other robots in this movie have their own personality traits that make them unique, why couldn't Otto be like that? Why couldn't he just formulate his own opinion about Earth and why he thinks it's beyond saving instead of just being a boring computer that does nothing? But yeah, other than that, everything else was just pretty okay. It's still funny, it's still emotional, and above all, very romantic. Just not one of my all-time favorites. Incredibles 2 was honestly a pretty good follow-up to the original. It still has everything. The jazzy score, the stellar animation, and all your fan favorite characters. Some things I like about this movie is that even though it follows the original by 14 years, it takes place immediately after the original movie takes place in, and it recreates the final scene of the original in Tony's perspective. Violet is also more entertaining in this one, like her character is more interesting and funny in this one, but Dash is still kind of uninteresting. It would have been neat to have the sequel see the kids as adults and how they're adjusting to their powers in their later years, but this is still good. I also like how this was a continuation of the first movie's story. Like, it goes further with the Supers Are Illegal plotline and shows how they become legal again. We also get to see more of Jack-Jack's powers, which was such a riot. And don't even get me started on the mid-swear moments. Those ones I did not expect to be in a Pixar movie, which is great. I sometimes like seeing mid-swear moments in an animated movie. And there are some problems, particularly with the villain. She's kind of predictable and her ideology isn't well fleshed out at all, making her somewhat of a pretty unmemorable villain. Also, the side heroes that Elastigirl introduces don't really have any personality outside of their powers and are just there. Except for Void, but she's not really around that much to actually be a character. It would have been better if Violet had just freed her right then and there when they were battling together on the yacht, and it would have made for a pretty good dynamic for the heroes, but unfortunately, no. But aside from those flaws, this is still a really good movie, with a couple things holding it back from being a true masterpiece like the first movie. But I still can't wait for a potential third film, hopefully not by another 14 years, that is.
You've got a friend in me.
Toy Story 1 is my least favorite Toy Story movie. I respect it, sure, I mean, it's still an all-time classic, but it might just be one of the most overrated Pixar movies, at least in my opinion. I could say a lot about the animation, but given this was the very first CGI animated movie ever, I'll let it slide. I didn't really like Woody in this one. Like, I understand that he's supposed to go through this character development where he goes from being really mean to more understanding, but honestly, for the majority of this movie, he's just such a big meanie head for so long that it makes some of this movie a little unpleasant to rewatch. In this one, he's just fueled by his jealousy and resentment, that his reconciliation with Buzz is, although compelling, also isn't all that fun. Another thing I don't really like about this movie is that the majority of it takes place in Sid's room. Like, it's not all that interesting, and it messes with the pacing a little bit, making it seem as if very little is going on to advance the story. Lastly, I feel like Toy Story 1 is just saying the least out of all the Toy Story movies. It doesn't really do much outside of setting up Woody and Buzz's relationship, and the side characters aren't all that interesting. The sequels, on the other hand, have way more interesting plot lines and more compelling side characters than this one. But that doesn't mean it's entirely terrible. This movie is really funny. The squabbles with Woody and Buzz are what got to me the most. It's also got its fair share of amazing bits, like the entire climax. But overall, Toy Story 1 is not my go-to, but it's still a memorable movie filled with plenty of jokes.
So please don't take my sunshine away.
Luca is one of the more simpler Pixar movies in recent years, but sometimes simple is good, and simple is enough to make this movie enjoyable and kind of cute. The story is about two sea monsters hiding their secret identities in a human town. The conflict is basically that they want to buy a Vespa and live free. There's no quest, no extravagance, or no reflection on self. It truly is the simplest movie Pixar has ever created. And you know what? That's perfectly fine. It's filled with imagination, cute memorable characters, and catchy Italian songs. Granted, it's not a Ratatouille, or an Up, or an Inside Out, or a Coco, or a Soul, but that's what makes it all the more better. The fact that the plot is this basic, it makes the movie flow a lot better, unlike some movies like Brave or The Good Dinosaur, both of which had potentially good ambitions, but the story and events that happen don't make those movies flow as much. Yeah, I don't know what else to say. Luca is honestly a really good, simple, family-friendly movie. It really is a different take on a Pixar movie, and I really like it for that reason. Pixar movies sometimes don't need to have an extravagant journey. They don't need to always have a big scale. They don't need to always have a big conflict. And it's really refreshing to see something this simple and turn out this good. It's not as creative as Soul, the movie that came before it, but I still like it and think it's really fun, and I definitely recommend you check it out if you haven't already.
Want that thing back where it came from? Oh, so help me.
Monsters, Inc. is a really good movie. I didn't see it as the flawless masterpiece a ton of people consider it, but it's still good. It's filled with a ton of fun, laughs, and many memorable gags. This is another Pixar film that I legit enjoyed. I like Mike and Sully's friendship and how it gets tested when Boo is revealed into their world. I also love the dynamic between Sully and Boo. That scene where Sully realizes how he scared Boo and that scaring children is nothing to be proud of is so heartfelt. Mr. Waternoose is a really great twist villain as well. Randall is intimidating and evil enough, but when you add on a second villain equivalent to bad CEOs in real life, that's some good stuff there. I really liked it. I also like the action scenes in this movie too, from the conveyor belt chase to the final battle, and it all leads up to that one brilliant emotional ending. It's so beautiful and iconic. I don't really know what else to say about this movie that you don't already know. It's Monsters, Inc. It's a really good movie, on top of being hilarious, exciting, and just overall a really fun time. I guess some parts drag on a bit too long, and some of it could have been a tad shorter. But at the end of the day, while it isn't an all-time favorite, I really enjoyed this movie for its message and for what it is alone. Monsters, Inc. was also the last time Pixar added bloopers to their film, so that's kind of sad.
I never met nobody like you.
Okay, so when Turning Red was literally first announced, I remember a lot of people getting really pissed at its weird animation and its weird character design. Myself admittedly included. But then I decided to give it a chance when it came out on Disney Plus. And you know what? Turning Red is one of the weirdest Pixar movies I've ever seen in my entire life. With that said, I kind of really like this movie. It's such a quirky, amazing film filled with catchy songs and some really enjoyable characters. It's also very funny, like I laughed at least two or three times rewatching it. Maybe some of it got a little too annoying and immature in some places. I mean, why did May have to twerk at her mother during the final battle? And while I did excuse some of the older pop culture songs that were added in to fit the early 2000s tone, other ones came off as out of place. I like most of the characters in this movie except Ming, but I'd be lying if I said some scenes involving May and her friends weren't a little
#cringe.
But it could have been much worse than how it was presented. Honestly, I was way more surprised to hear the words like crap and stripper in a Pixar movie, which is not what you would regularly expect, which is what makes this movie stand out from the pack. Plus, that's one of the many things I like about this movie. I find a strange sort of fondness in the cringe elements. It makes the film really distinct and entertaining in its own way, compared to the rest of Pixar's lineup. On top of the humor, it has endearing characters, strong emotion, instantly repeatable songs, and a deep message that many Asian communities and young individuals can definitely connect with. I just unexpectedly had a really good time with Turning Red. It's definitely up there as one of the most overhated Pixar movies in recent years for sure. Like, come on, Turning Red is just really good. Not a masterpiece, but still very fun.
I'm so excited! I've always wanted to see The Little Mermaid!
Out of all the non-Toy Story Pixar sequels, Finding Dory is easily the best one to come out in the late 2010s. Like, yeah, it's kind of weird how Dory gets these random flashbacks of her childhood in order to keep the plot going. Some of it is compelling, others were pretty predictable. Marlin and Nemo also didn't add much to the story, with the exception of the "What would Dory do?" scene that I found really satisfying. There also aren't nearly as many characters in this movie compared to the original, but aside from that, Finding Dory is still really good. Honestly, I had an amazing time with this movie. Every aspect of Dory's backstory, like how she speaks whale and how she can read, is all because she grew up in this aquarium, and I thought that was explained pretty well. I also love the message this movie gives to people with disabilities, and how this movie introduces characters who all have some sort of specific character flaw, but none of those issues define who they are as a whole. Dory has trouble with her memory, Hank is missing an arm, Destiny has trouble seeing, Bailey briefly lost his echolocation, but none of those weaknesses define who they are now. And throughout this movie, we see Dory grappling with her loss of memory, and it all leads up to the most emotional scene in the entire movie. Finding Dory is just, all in all, a good time, and a pretty solid sequel to Finding Nemo. It was definitely worth a 13-year-long wait. It may not make you cry in the first 10 minutes like in the original, but hey, not every movie has to. Alright, we have entered the top 10. The 8 out of 10 movies and above. Some of these Pixar movies are actually some of my favorites. So, yeah, let's move on.
I'm Joy!
I'm Sadness.
I'm Anger.
I'm Disgust.
I'm Pooh.
Inside Out is a great movie, and one of Pixar's better films to come out during the 2010s. This is hands down the most creative Pixar movie I have ever seen. There's a film studio that makes Riley's dreams, there's an abstract thought room that makes things non-figurative, and there's different areas of Riley's childhood in between her new interests. There's a lot of creative concepts that make this movie so engaging in every way. And the characters are all really likable, especially Joy. I love her character arc throughout the film, by realizing the importance of sadness and how it's okay to feel different emotions, not just the positive ones. I especially love how it's presented, showcasing Joy's attempts to cheer Bing Bong up or wake Riley up through happiness, only for sadness to showcase the importance of negative feelings. This movie really understands the importance of all emotions and how not to shun others down, even in the most difficult situations, which is one of many reasons why people find this movie relatable in their own lives. In spite of some ridiculous plot holes, I still had a lot of fun with this movie. It's just really great, and when it first came out, it was more than that. It was like the first Pixar movie in 5 years to be up to the same level of quality as their movies during the 2000s. Toy Story 3 was great, but Cars 2, Brave, and Monsters University were less successful than its predecessors. But thankfully, that issue was resolved when this movie was released. And then things took a nosedive all over again.
Damn it!
I was a lonesome cowboy.
I might just be the biggest defender for this next movie on the list. I mean, aside from these guys. But I'll stick with my opinion that Toy Story 4, the unnecessary sequel, actually turned out really great. Like, it seemed like the stupidest decision ever, right? Why continue a franchise that ended so perfectly? Well, you have to understand that although this movie didn't feel necessary, it actually tells a really strong story that gives a different take about what a toy's purpose is. The first three movies were all about how important toys are as a child's plaything, whereas the fourth movie brings in an all-new idea for how important toys are as their own person. And throughout the entire movie, we see Woody trying to find meaning in his life after he doesn't receive love from his owner anymore. Not just as a toy, but as his own individual. But with Bo's help, Woody's able to find new purpose in life by becoming a lost toy and helping other toys find their owners. This is what makes his goodbye both heart-wrenching and necessary, because he's dedicating his life to a noble cause instead of going to the museum or staying with Andy in college. He doesn't go with either of these other paths in the previous films because he values the love of a child more than anything else. His mission with Andy is complete, and Bonnie will be okay without him, and it's time for him to live his own life with Bo. The only gripe I have with this movie is Gabby Gabby. If she really wanted Woody's voice box that badly, why couldn't she just go up and tell him in the first place instead of having her dummies chase him around the store and literally rip out his back half? Like, really? That was your plan? I mean, aside from that, Toy Story 4 is amazing. Sure, it's not as good as 2 or 3, but I love it nonetheless. It's a perfect conclusion to Woody's journey, but apparently not a good enough conclusion for the franchise, that's for sure. Soul is another movie that I find amazing. That's a smidge better than Inside Out, yet still put beneath Coco ever so slightly. This is just a really powerful movie filled with important life lessons that'll click more with adults than kids. It tackles its issue in the sort of intellectual manner on the same concepts than Inside Out and Coco. It's all about how you don't have to do great things to live a great life. Soul also not only has some amazing graphic-like feel into this new introduced Soul world, but has a very unique way of showcasing the simple ways of life and the different emotions of the characters. On top of that, it's also funny, sad, and deep, which is admittedly not a lot of the other recent Pixar movies have had. Despite some clunkiness with the story, it's a true treat, and I definitely recommend you check it out. Coco is a masterpiece, no surprise. It's not the best Pixar movie, it's still one of the best movies, but it's got some things holding it back. It's not really all that funny, the pacing is a little weak in some places, and the final battle feels a little rushed and there's not as much tension as there should be, but despite all those flaws, Coco is such an astounding movie that tells such a powerful story about family, loss, and grief that makes the film all the more emotional. Along with that, it's also filled with amazing landscapes, enjoyable characters, strong themes, emotional warmth, and it fully embraces in its portrayal of culture in ways that most modern Disney movies rarely do. Except in Encanto, but that was later. And come on, the ending is straight up the best to come out of Pixar. It's so hard to not cry on. It's really amazing how flawlessly this movie comes to a close. Yeah, Coco is such a phenomenal movie, and definitely the best Pixar movie to come out during the 2010s. It's miraculously great, it's super catchy, it's Coco, man. What's not to love?
This little rat is guilty!
Ratatouille is easily Pixar's most artistic film. It has everything. Fantastic animation, astounding cutscenes, and really relaxing music that fits very well with the movie. Michael Giacchino delivers a ton to this film, I swear, he's really amazing. It is leaps and bounds ahead of Pixar's other films in the 2000s, and is why I think Brad Bird is one of the best Pixar directors ever, below Pete Docter. It's smart, clever, mature, and somewhat emotional. It's so amazing in the realm of animation, especially considering how early on this was in Pixar's career. Remy and Linguini make for a really good duo, and a great dynamic for this movie. The Linguini storyline is very relatable and touching, especially when he's around Colette. The Remy storyline is enticing, fun, and kind of heartfelt. This movie tells a really fantastic story about following your dreams and not letting anything or anyone tell you different. And throughout this movie, we see Remy coaching Linguini through his unique cooking abilities. It all leads to a deep ending with a connectable message along with it. I could go on about this movie, but you already know how amazing it turned out to be. Despite it being kind of your typical lie reveal plot, Ratatouille is still such a hard movie to hate. It is a masterpiece of a gourmet dish that people will still be serving and talking about to this day. Toy Story 3 is honestly the better finale for the franchise. I'm glad Pixar kept going, no doubt, if not for the success of some of their other movies released around the 2010s. But like, when you continue a supposedly perfect finale with another chapter to the story, with another on the way, what exactly does this chapter have? Simple. A handful of brand new characters, intense drama, a perfect continuation of its predecessor that expands upon the world, and an absolutely hilarious prison break. Spanish Buzz still gets me. Like, I remember reenacting Buzz's dancing around my sister, who's supposedly Jessie, the last time I watched this movie. It was very funny. Yeah, there's very little that I dislike with this movie, and I feel like this would have been an excellent place to stop. The only issue that I have is how the toys don't believe Woody was right about Andy putting them in the attic. Like, in a way, I can understand the toys' perspectives after Andy called them junk. Like, I can understand why they feel this way, but it was still kind of weird how they don't trust Woody after all those years. Aside from that, Toy Story 3 is still an emotional roller coaster. I love how all the toys get a chance to shine together as a group in this one. The darker tone is spot on. The jokes and emotional bits still hit. It's tear-jerking, it's amazing, and you know it. Finding Nemo is a true masterpiece. I had an amazing time with it as a kid, and it's still great as a teen. This movie has some really strong emotional moments and plenty of jokes that make it both unique and funny. It also has some great messages for both parents and kids to connect with, and many of the chase scenes were tense and hilarious, like that weird seagull chase. The side characters are all really likable and enjoyable, from the sharks to the sea turtles to the tank gang. That turtle current is by far my most favorite part in the entire movie. I also really like Dory in this one too. It's really cool how she's able to find a fun way around situations, like in the scene with all those jellyfish. The tag gang is also really enjoyable too, like I said before. His expectations go through the roof and give the film an amazing sense of scale and wonder, which is what makes it slightly better than Finding Dory for me. Yeah, I really don't know what else to say about this movie. It's simply fantastic. I'm happy to revisit it once in a while, and I can truly understand why people rank this as one of Pixar's best films. I know I do. Woody's Roundup, right here every day. Toy Story 2 is a masterpiece and a huge improvement over the original in every possible way. It's honestly the funniest Toy Story movie out of all of them. It made me laugh again and again, it just kept the jokes coming. Like, come on, they referenced Star Wars, that's how you know it's super hilarious. On top of the humor, it tells such a unique story about abandonment, grief, love, and so much more. It also manages to deal with deep concepts on top of being enjoyable and fun for families and friends alike. The movie focuses more on Woody this time and his worry of not being loved by his kid after he got a ripped arm. But despite this, it's amazing how he decides it's worth it to stick by Andy and give Jessie and Bullseye another chance to shine again as a plaything. They know all the joy of being loved by a kid will eventually end, but at least they'll all be together for infinity and beyond. Dude, I don't know what else to say about this movie that you don't already know. Toy Story 2 is just simply amazing. It expands the universe, it continues the story in a new direction, and introduces new enjoyable characters, and it's filled with emotional beats and funny moments. It doesn't get better than this. The Incredibles, a story about superheroes that were forced to go underground. But there's one hero in particular that wants to relive the glory days. This movie is honestly really fantastic, from the action scenes to the villain to the score. Like I've said, Michael Giacchino is a legend. The Incredibles delivers a shockingly mature screenplay with plenty of adult-like dramatic weight and themes. From insurance company practices to huge relationship squabbles to the massive amount of deaths. It also tells a strong story about a man trapped in a world of mediocrity, longing to relive the golden age of his life, until he finally learns to let go of the past and love and appreciate his family for who they are. And of course, they're superheroes. What else there is to say? The way this movie starts off as a superhero adventure, continues as a character drama, and then finishes once again as a superhero movie is mind-blowing and so great in every way. The Incredibles has got to be up there as one of the best Pixar movies ever, and also the best animated superhero movie released by Disney ever. Way better than Big Hero 6, in my opinion. Go check it out if for some reason you haven't. It's super. Yeah, this shouldn't really be a surprise. Up is the absolute best movie Pixar has ever made. Pete Docter's movies have all hit us in a certain way, from Monsters, Inc. to Soul. But this is Pete Docter's best directed movie of all time. And I'm not just saying that because of the opening alone. It tells an absolutely heartwarming story about grief, loss, and the joy of the simplicity of life, while also being fun and adventurous. Doug, Kevin, and Russell are good tag-alongs, and the villain is great. And Carl is honestly one of my favorite Pixar protagonists. His story is extremely relatable, what with his wife dying, and how he promised to help Ellie get to her dream spot. And when he learns that his life with Ellie had been the adventure all along, is the best revolution out of any Pixar film. Up is just really great and takes such a deep risk at being adventurous, funny, and all around very emotional. And even though there are other older Pixar movies like Toy Story 1 or WALL-E that others consider to be the best Pixar movies, Up is nonetheless my pick for Pixar's best film ever. And there's really nothing else that I think can top this incredible masterpiece of an animated movie. Anyway, that was the entire list. Did you enjoy it? Is there more I could have said? Do you agree or disagree with some of my spots? If so, let me know down below. Also, let me know when Pixar's future films come out. I actually want to check those out.
Do I want a Toy Story 5?
No!
Either way, that's about it. See you in the next video.